Hey, you ever heard of Squid Game? You know, the Korean Netflix series that took the world by storm in 2021 and drilled itself into the cultural zeitgeist?
Oh, I'm about to get that gift card, Alex. Look at me go, Alex. See you up there, Alex, 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 Alex.
Yeah, it's pretty damn good, actually. The directing is sharp and powerful. It has great performances and a striking soundtrack. The designs are instantly iconic. I mean, you just layer three circles on top of each other, bing, bang, boom. Squid Games. It's written with a mix of thrills and drama that seems practically tailor-made to be a hit. It's practically a perfect series.
What convinced you to bet so much on number 69?
Oh, it's such a beautiful number! 69!
Oh, you dirty dog.
Okay, almost a perfect series. And at its core is powerful social commentary about the exploitation of the poor by the rich, but also something more elemental and personal. That brings me to one of the very few things people don't seem to like about the series, which is the twist in the final episode. But that twist is the key to unlocking the real meaning of Squid Game. So this isn't a comprehensive review of the show, but I just want to focus on that twist and how it really did work for me. Now, if you're watching this without having seen the show, like, seriously, what are you still doing here? I'm about to spoil the show. But just in case you haven't and somehow still want to watch this video, let me briefly summarize. The series follows Gi-hun, a Korean father desperately down on his luck. He's surrounded by loan sharks he owes money to, and he tries whatever he can to win the cash needed to save his life. One day, he's given an invite to an event where he can win money by playing games. Boom, he's in the games. The 9-episode series follows him through 6 events where the penalty for losing is death, but the prize for winning is a jackpot of 45.5 billion won. He encounters other characters who have their own predicaments. There's Sebyak, a young woman who escaped from North Korea with her younger brother and is desperate to get her mother over the border as well. There's Ali, a migrant worker from Pakistan, eager to reunite with his wife and child. There's Il-nam, an old man with a brain tumor who is nevertheless the most positive one on the team. And there's Sang-woo, Gi-hun's old friend who went to Seoul National University to study business. Ultimately though, Gi-hun is the protagonist of the series. He's introduced first, while we don't get the others' backstories until the 2nd episode. The focus is primarily on him, figuring out how to get through games like Red Light Green Light, the Dalgona Candy Cutout Game, Tug of War, Extreme Hopscotch, and the most emotionally devastating game of marbles I've ever seen in my life.
Kumo. 나랑 같이 해줘서.
Actually, yeah, let me focus on this episode for a bit, because this is some damn fine television. Basically, all the players are instructed to pair up, and while everyone else pairs with someone they view as being particularly strong or fast or smart or dexterous, Gi-hun partners with Il-nam, the old man that no one else wants to play with. But the game is revealed to be marbles, meaning that within each pair, one person has to be eliminated. Sang-woo deceives Ali into handing over his marbles, while Sebyak has another girl throw the game for her. And Gi-hun and Il-nam, well, Gi-hun gets unlucky at first with the guessing game they've devised. Il-nam's dementia begins to set in more though, and Gi-hun takes advantage of it, changing his answers and cheating back almost all the marbles. But at the end of the game, the old man suddenly reveals that he did know all along that he was being deceived. And he still hands over his last marble willingly, sacrificing himself. By the end of the series, Gi-hun faces Sang-woo, his old childhood friend, with the final game being the titular Squid Game, which in reality devolves into a knife fight. Gi-hun finally gets the upper hand, but he refuses to kill Sang-woo. He offers to throw the game because the rules state that they can force it to end at any point if a majority of players agree. But Sang-woo instead sacrifices himself, crowning Gi-hun a devastated winner. By the time he gets home, he goes to meet his mother, whom he'd hoped to help get medical care with his winnings, and finds her collapsed dead on the floor. It sends him into a dark spiral, and a year later we see that he's barely touched his winnings. He's a rich man, but he doesn't feel like a rich man, even bumming petty cash off his investment banker. But he gets an invitation to a meeting from his ganbu. He rushes to the rendezvous, and we get the twist. Oh Il-nam is still alive. And it turns out, he was a mysterious host of the games all along. Now at first the twist made me think, wait, what? I wasn't sure what to think of it right off the bat. But as the scene unfolds, it begins to make more sense what's going on here. Il-nam looks out his window and spies a homeless man. Ignoring Gi-hoon's demands for answers, he challenges him to one last game. If someone helps the homeless man before midnight, Gi-hoon wins and is allowed to kill him. Otherwise, well, it's not clear what Gi-hoon has at stake. Now the obvious answer to this would be for Gi-hoon to realize he can help the man himself, because the rules are just someone has to help him. That's how I would have written this. But again, that's not what's going on here. There's a different motivation at play, and I'll explain that in a little bit. As the two men watch, we start to get answers. Il-nam is a financier, and the reason he put on the games was to just have fun with his friends. It seems almost anticlimactic that the tier of Squid Game antagonists goes from pink-masked soldiers to the hooded front man to the crude wannabe furry VIPs to this old man dying on a sickbed. And his ultimate goal was just because he wanted to have fun. But listen to how he phrases it.
자네, 돈이 하나도 없는 사람과 돈이 너무 많은 사람의 공통점이 뭔 줄 아나? 사는 게 재미가 없다는 거야. 돈이 너무 많으면은 아무리 뭘 사고 먹고 마셔도 결국 다 시시해져 버려.
He points out that people voluntarily signed up. They could end the games at any time through a simple majority vote, which they did. And in fact, with a move that retroactively carries more weight, Il-nam broke the tie in favor of letting everyone go. But people still chose to come back after facing how desperate the situation was in the outside world. And after thinking about this, I began to understand what the show was really about. The message of Squid Game isn't rich people bad, poor people sad. It's about a world where those who are financially successful and those that aren't are both unhappy. A world without fulfillment. A world without joy or innocence or excitement. A world that has forgotten what it's like to be a child. The motif of childhood prevails through the series. There's a reason that all the challenges are deadly versions of children's games. The very first scene is Gi-hoon reminiscing about playing the Squid Game as a kid, and how he would feel on top of the world when he won. Contrast that with his trauma and depression upon winning the games. The villain of the games for so long was Dok-soo, but slowly it pivots to Gi-hoon's old friend Sang-woo, the relationship brought to the breaking point as the games drive them apart. Besides being his friend, Sang-woo also acts as a foil to Gi-hoon. In the outside world, he is wanted for fraud. He was a cutthroat who went too far. And that shows up more as he shuns established allies for whom he believes to be fitter teammates, then unfairly deceives Ali, shoves a man cruelly off the glass platforms, and then murders Sebyeok to keep Gi-hoon from being too attached to her. He's cold, calculated, cynical. Gi-hoon, in contrast, shows compassion and kindness. In the first episode, he's basically a man-child, short-sighted and irresponsible, but still with a good heart. During the games, he offered to work with people even if they could be a liability. His team were often the underdogs. And just before the marble game, again, he offered to pair off with Il-nam, whom nobody else wanted to play with, since he was thought to be the greatest liability. And notice this thing they do.
이렇게 해서 뺐든가?
예, 맞아요. 이렇게.
Again, a childish gesture of friendship, the motif coming in again. Yet the violence of the games has worn on Gi-hoon, and when it turns out that the marble game will be against Il-nam, he begins to cheat out of desperation. But at the very end, when he's finally confronted about it, look at him. Look how shattered he is, the expression on his face. It's shame, it's horror at himself and what he let himself become. He breaks down crying, and Il-nam still embraces him, letting him know it'll be alright. Gi-hun almost became like Sang-woo. For a moment, he'd lost his kindness. And this is a reminder to him that he can't do that. With the twist in mind, the scene does, in retrospect, lose the gravity of Il-nam sacrificing his life. It also gains the gravity of Gi-hun's soul being saved. And so in the last game, when Gi-hun gets the upper hand over Sang-woo, he doesn't finish things off. He doesn't take that last step to victory. Instead, he returns and offers to quit the game so they can both go home alive. And Sang-woo, moved by this act of mercy, begins to reminisce about their childhoods.
어릴 때 형이랑 이러고 놀다 보면 꼭 엄마가 밥 먹으라고 불렀는데 이제는 아무도 안 부르는데.
No one calls us anymore. In a world where extended family homes have given way to the quote-unquote modern nuclear family, there's no support. Growing up often means having no one to lean on, nobody to support and care for you. And in a world of predatory practices, both legal or not, it breeds loneliness and alienation and cynicism. A child doesn't know how to be cynical or conniving or callous. They have to learn. Sang-woo did. Gi-hun did not. That's what made him Ganbu with Il-nam. And that's why he's here, back at the scene. And when he asks why the old man was in the games himself, Il-nam replies, for the first time, with a real smile on his face.
어릴 땐 말이야. 친구들이랑 뭘 하고 놀아도 재밌었어. 죽기 전에 꼭 한번 다시 느끼고 싶었어. 자네 덕에 기억도 나지 않던 오래전 일들이 떠올랐어.
Playing with Gi-hun felt like playing with a childhood friend, because while other people had brute strength on their side, or sadism, or cheated the rules, or tricked and backstabbed their way forward, Gi-hun only had the fact that he was, basically, a good person. And that's why his Ganbu invited him here. Why he put forward this challenge, because once again, Il-nam intends to lose. Because the homeless man is rescued, a woman stopping by and then bringing back someone to help, almost exactly at midnight. It's a game about human nature, and optimism has won out. And at the same time, Il-nam passes away. Gi-hun addresses him one last time.
당신도 봤지? 당신이 졌어.
But Il-nam didn't see. His eyes remained fixed upwards, relishing his memories. For the second time in the series, he saves Gi-hun's soul. The first time, he turned the man away from cruelty. This time, he turns the man towards hope. Il-nam might have failed the game on the surface, but he succeeded in his real goal. In a sense, both of them won this challenge. Squid Game is not about the games. It's not about how to min-max your way to the number one victory royale. It's also not just about how terrible capitalism is. It's about growing up in a world where things can be terrible and brutal, how it pulls you away from the innocence and joy of being a child, and how, just maybe, there's a way to preserve some of that innocence and joy into adulthood.